So, let me go back to Romans chapter 1, verse 18. 2 weeks ago, we were talking in Romans 2. I want to go back to make sure we understand some things. First thing I want us to understand is that we're not saved by doing works, but works are characteristic of a genuine believer. And God, when God judges, he judges according to truth. And what we have, so in Romans 1:18, what we have, the Apostle Paul in Romans 1, 2, and 3 is proving that it doesn't matter who you are, you sin and come short of the glory of God. Whether you Jew or Gentile, bond or free, whether you male or female, black or white, you have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So he starts out again in Romans 1:18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. He said, because, verse 19, what may be known of God is evident, it's manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. And he goes on to say, for God has shown it to them, verse 20, for since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made. Now, what Paul is doing as a great, tremendous attorney at law, he's showing that, look, everybody has sinned and come short of the glory of God. So what happens when you go to Romans 1:18, the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth. Many people say, well, that's not me. That's what we get into chapter 2. Paul says, you're without excuse, whoever you are to judges. In other words, I've just told you the wrath that God has revealed. And what you do is you say, yeah, I realize so on these other folks, yeah, they're the wrath of God. Yeah, they're terrible. But that's not me. The Pharisee in Luke 18 was praying. See, Paul gets this from Jesus. He's been with Jesus. Paul says, here's what Jesus says. The Pharisee in Luke 18 is praying, and he starts to pray, Lord, I thank you. I'm not like other people. Mm-hmm. Well, that's the way I thought about myself. I'm ashamed to admit it. I thought I was better than other folks. Because of what? I didn't cheat on my wife. I didn't commit adultery. I brought home my paycheck. I wasn't drunk. I wasn't this. And I used to say I'm a BMW, not a Mercedes. Say, what's a BMW? I'm a black man working. You don't find many of them. You see what I'm saying? Go ahead, my brother. No, you're fine.
But I just got a call from Michael Peterson.
Okay.
Michael Peterson,
yes. Okay, yeah, I know you're talking about this is because of the Bill Johnson. Okay, we want to lead us? What's that? Okay. Yes, Father. And Father, as we were praying for our brother, we realized that, as Tony Evans says, we're not the home team anymore. And when we stand for Jesus Christ, there's a lot of opposition. And the opposition is now becoming more and more, not only vocal, but now violent. And as our brother said, as somebody spits in your face, and the different things that we read about Jesus said if someone slaps you on the right side, turn the cheek. In other words, don't retaliate in the flesh like was the normal. You slap me, I'll slap you. But so, Father, we're praying as we are in these times when men do not endure sound doctrine, that we would represent you well. So we thank you, Father. The power of the Holy Spirit is what we need, the direction, the guidance, the power, the provision of the Holy Spirit, so that we represent you well in these times. So we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, let's go back to Romans 1:18 for just a minute. Amen. Romans 1:18, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness. Now, ungodliness is the idea that we don't reverence God the way we should. Before we accepted Christ, who reverenced God the way that we should? Anybody here can raise your hand and say, I did. I gave God all the reverence he deserved. No, we didn't. So ungodliness, everyone is guilty of ungodliness. The Pharisee is saying, I'm not like other people. I go to church, I fast, I do this, I do that, I give. But you're not giving God the glory that's due unto his name. Psalm 29, Psalm 96. God, the reverence that God is deserving, We don't do that. So we're all guilty of, we were ungodly. So the Bible will say in Romans, when we were ungodly, Christ died for us. He didn't wait till we start giving God the praise that he deserves. He died for us. So, and it says, and unrighteousness, all unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth and unrighteousness. So by my lifestyle, I'm suppressing the truth that should be there. I don't reverence God the way I should. So we went through this in the 80s or so, 70s or 80s. A number of people I talked to said, I was forced to go to church, but I'm not going now. And I'm raising my kids. If they want to go when they turn 18, I ain't taking them to church. I'm not going to give them, I'm not going to give God the reverence that he deserves. He's given me these children. And so the children belong to the Lord. Children are a heritage of the Lord. So God's given me children. They belong to him. I'm supposed to live in such a way that they see God in me. And so the Bible will say in Ephesians, don't provoke the fathers, don't provoke your children to wrath. How we do that? Because we don't teach them anything. Right. And so we're provoking them to, they're going to face the wrath of God. And so like this young lady said to me at East High when she was going down the hall, cussing up a storm, and I stopped. And I looked, and she said, what you looking at? I said, well, I hadn't said anything to you. I said, I just heard what you were saying. She said, you think that's something? I'll bring my mother down here and let her cuss you out. You think I can cuss? Meet my mother. So you looking at, and I said, young lady, but did I really say anything to you? I know you ain't said nothing. I'm just letting you know. So, and that's a lot of places. So when you don't bring people up, as Paul says, in the fear and nurture of the Lord, you don't bring your kids up, you're provoking them to wrath. Amen? So as I was, I'm thinking about my grandson. I'm crying about my grandson. And so when my daughter's telling me what happened, and she says, we were all together on Thanksgiving, but she didn't tell me. She said, Daddy, I forgot. I ain't mad at you. I understand. You thinking, my mother just died, all this. You trying to protect me. Thank you. I appreciate that. I ain't mad at you. And so we got off the phone. My grandson calls me, and I'm going, man. But I'm praying for him. See, his brother Joshua, y'all know Joshua. Joshua's come to know Jesus. You know Lindsay. But my brother Jordan. So, I know we all praying for family members. Lord, and what the Lord used that to lay on my heart, the coming year is the year of prayer. We're going to emphasize praying for our families. That's what God laid on my heart. I spared him. I could have called him home. He's still alive. So we're going to keep praying for each other and our family. So God laid on my heart, I said, 2024, the year of prayer. Starting with Matthew 6, Matthew 7, and 1 John 5, 14, the year of prayer. The wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness. After we get saved, we realize we have not given God the praise that is due unto his name. Everybody with me? So let's go to verse 1 of chapter 2. Chapter 2, verse 1. And so we're looking at people who are saying in Romans 2, 1, they're saying, I understand what you're saying about ungodliness and about unrighteousness and people who commit these kind of things, but that's not me. And it says, therefore, you are inexcusable, O man, whoever you are who judge. You're pointing a finger. Yeah, they deserve to go to hell. They deserve your wrath. The Pharisees said, but that ain't me. I thank God I'm not like other men. This publican, he's messed up. I'm not like this publican. And they went on as Pharisees. They would say, Lord, I thank God that you didn't make me a woman, because women are no good either. Where'd you get that from? You see what I'm saying? So he's thinking he's better than, and so Paul comes along and says, let me tell you, whoever you are to judge, and whatever you judge another, you condemn yourself, for you who judge practice the same things. You get that? You who judge. So what is he saying when he sees you do the same thing? Because I was saying, I don't cheat on my wife. I'm not drunk. I don't come home. I don't throw my money away. I'm not doing what he's doing. But the question from the depths of the heart of your heart, you see, he says, are you giving God the glory? You see what I'm saying? Are you giving God all the godliness? Are you reverencing him like you should? Well, no. Well, you just like somebody else. You may not have done exactly what they did, but what you're doing comes from your same principle. You're ungodly. And then the Lord showed me, he says, you see, the way you lived your life, you have defiled your wife and your family because you taught them ungodliness. So what do you mean? How'd you teach them? Because you work at a General Motors, you're doing fine. I gave you this opportunity. You know, you're working 6-7 days a week. You're making real good money, more money than you ever made before in your life. You got it made. You're laying there on the couch. And your wife says, let's go to church. I ain't going to church. I work too hard. Finally got a Sunday off. I'm laying in the bed. I'm going to rest. I'm going to watch football. You go. I ain't going. You see what I'm saying? So you're looking at that and you go, man, the Lord could have struck me dead then. Yeah, he said, okay, you going to watch football? What if I decide you ain't watching football? Yeah, you see what I'm saying? And so when you look at people who are ungodly and unrighteous and doing things, and the Lord has said, showing me, I was the same way. I'm making sense to you. I was the same way. I might not have done exactly the same thing, but my lifestyle was one out of ungodliness because I didn't reverence God the way that I should. Go ahead, my sister.
This is amazing how, you know, a lot of things you don't remember.
Yeah.
I don't know what you remember. I always can remember that Sunday morning, my grandfather was in that kitchen table studying his Sunday school lesson, and he didn't have maybe but a fourth or fifth grade education.
Yes, go ahead.
And he would come in that bedroom, wake me up, he would have his coffee, and then he would study his lesson. He'd come in and have
okay.
Saying, if he can't read that book, why are you trying to teach me? And now that God allowed me to read and teach the Sunday school, all the time I said, thank you, Lord. He should have struck me down all the way going back to that bed, trying to get in my bed to go back to sleep. Because my grandfather was trying to teach the word of God, and I thought I was somebody because I had a little high school education, and I knew some words that he didn't know. I'm not
Yeah,
that is. I was evil. I was mad. I was evil. And it's amazing how God let me remember. I don't remember a whole lot.
All right. Thank you. I appreciate that. Anybody else? So you see, what we're looking at is who Paul is talking to, the historical setting. And so look at verse 2, Romans 2:2. He says, "But we know that the judgment of God is according to truth against those who practice such things." See, the judgment of God is based upon truth. And so we're going back over this, what we talked about 2 weeks ago. It's not based upon what I say, Julius, how Julius professes and what Julius thinks. It's not based upon that. It's based upon what I'm doing, okay? So God's judgment. So, and that's the way it always is. He judges sin when we sin, and he's going to judge God. He's going to judge sin in finality when unbelievers stand before him, and he's going to judge sin. You and I as believers, our sins have been judged in Christ, okay? So all we have to answer for is what kind of rewards we're going to get. But we're not going to be judged according to sin because Jesus paid it all. And you understand that. So I'm not going to stand before God and God says, "You know, when you were a pastor and you did this, you sinned this." No, all that's forgiven. But what's going to happen when I stand before God and my life is reviewed after I got saved, then the Lord is going to show things, and I'm going to get rewards for what I have done for the Lord, okay? Not only what I've done, but the motives and all that. I get rewards. And then I get loss of reward for what I could have done. And so, you see what I'm saying? Here's what I'm saying. Again, I always give this example, that when I graduated from high school, and they were given attendance awards. Now, I had some awards, and I remember I'm missing some school days. I only missed a couple. Because I ain't going to school. And when they gave awards for attendance, and people walked across the stage, and I'm going, "That should be me." Nobody was fussing at me. Nobody was mad at me. But I'm looking, I could have got that reward. I only missed a couple of days. And if I'd have got up and went to school like I should have, I'd have been getting this reward. So that when you and I face Jesus, Jesus paid for all sins, and so we don't have to answer for that. Making sense to you? It's not going to happen. But what we're going to remember is we'll look at some things and go, "You know what? I could have done this, or I could have done that." There are some times when, you know, I'm strong in my witness, and there are some times when I'm not as strong as I should be. And so... And even now I experience that someone's talking to someone, and I'm saying, "Man, I should have been saying that to that brother." You know, and someone else said it, and I walked out not saying it. And you're feeling bad, and God is not saying, "You're going to hell. You sin." I'm feeling bad because I could have done what I didn't do. You see what I'm saying? And go ahead.
That comes under obedience, right?
Exactly. And so there's a loss of reward. So God was not going to reward me. He said, "Remember that day when you walked out of the restaurant? Here's the reward for witnessing." I'm going, "Lord, I didn't witness." "Oh, okay, loss of reward." I'm trying to help you to understand. I don't get the reward because I didn't do what God has called me to do. I'm not going to pay for that in sin. I just lose the reward I could have gotten. And so when we see Jesus, the idea to see Jesus and look at, "Man, how I could have lived for him and I didn't," is going to make us enough sorrow in that we're going to, throughout all eternity, being with Jesus, we're going to realize the importance of being, as you said, obedient. Am I making sense to you? I'll tell you that there's one day my wife and I were on a cruise, and somehow we got off, we got at odds against one another. Man, I don't know what kind of stupid was on the, we wanted a cruise. We wanted to go on Southern Caribbean, so we landed in Puerto Rico, and we went to various places: Aruba, Antigua, Saint Lucia, and somewhere on that cruise, we got upset with each other, And I came into the room, and she's crying. And she said, Julius, I don't want to argue. I'm sorry. And I'm going, I'm the one with the attitude. So I'm crying because we on a cruise. We plan. We want to be together. And I got a stupid attitude. And she's crying. Lord, forgive me. And I hugged her. The rest of the cruise is beautiful. You see? So we didn't lose out on being married. But we lost out on those couple of days when we was at odds against one another. And when both of them, it was a stupid attitude. When I see Jesus, he's interceding for me. I died for you, young fella. Died for you. He's not going to say, you didn't do this, you didn't do that. I'm going to remember, Lord, I could have been a better pastor. I could have been a better husband. I could have been this and that. And so that's the loss of reward. Are you with me? I ain't going to hell, I know that. I'm going to be with him throughout all eternity. That's not what he's talking about. But for unbelievers, go ahead.
It's sort of like even with your parents after they passed.
Yes.
Things that you could have done more for, you know?
Yeah.
So when you get to heaven then.
Yeah, they ain't mad and you ain't mad, but you
right,
see.
Right, but you just wish you could have.
There you go. Good point. So the judgment, again, is against, is according to truth, against those who practice such things. So I look at my life. Before Jesus came into my life, was I ungodly? Yes. Was I unrighteous? Yes. Because I had my own standard of righteousness, which not was not his. It was a lot less. And so it's easy to point a finger at someone else. So one of my friends, he loved to point a finger at smokers. This guy, he's come to Christ, and he's still smoking. He's smoking. If he ought to let God deliver him from that. And I've told him that. Man, this smoke, you smoking, you ain't living the way you should be because God can deliver you from smoking. The guy weighed 300 pounds, 5'2". The Lord ought to deliver you from eating. You see what I'm saying? Oh, eating is fine. That's, no problem. Man, you keep on, you're going to die. You see, but you pointing the finger at smoking, and the brother is. I mean, he has admitted. I'm having a struggle. I'm doing this, but you ain't struggling at all. You go, you know, he go home and smoke a cigarette. You go home, eat three pieces of pie. I know during one of those pieces, God is saying you need to quit. So judgment is according to truth against those who practice. Verse 3, Romans 2:3. And do you think this, O man, you who judge those practicing such things and doing the same, that you will escape the judgment of God? And the answer is, before we say, human beings think that. I'm fine. Again, I was talking to a guy that he doesn't know the Lord, but he insists he's going to heaven. Well, we don't want to put that on. Nobody heard that. We good. Otherwise, that's going to be on YouTube. Verse 4, Romans 2:4. It's coming up, Romans 2:4, okay. You got it, bro? There it is. Or do you despise the riches of his goodness, forbearance, and long-suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leads you to repentance? So God being good, here's what natural human beings think. God is good to me. I'm getting away. I'm getting away with this. No, you're not. The goodness, the forbearance, and the long suffering is to lead you to repentance. So verse 5, Romans 2:5 says, but here's the problem. So how are you responding to God's goodness? But in accordance with your hardness and your impenitent heart, you are treasuring up for yourself wrath in the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God. God judges according to the truth, not according to what I'm professing. I'm going to go to verse 6 here. And so as we're looking at, you see what we're saying? Trying to help you understand that. So 2:6, if you take this out of context and just don't deal with it in the context, says God will render to each one according to his deeds. Romans 2:7. And here's the one, the clincher I wanted to get to as we go back and we're reviewing this thing. Eternal life to those who by patient continuance in doing good seek for glory, honor, and immortality. This verse is not teaching that you get eternal life by doing good. Okay, you see what I'm saying? If you take that verse out of the context, he's talking to people like the Pharisee who say that I thank God I'm not like other people. And so being not like other people, God's wrath is not going to hit me because I pray, I do this, I do that, I don't do this, I don't do those things. And but Paul is saying, but you are ungodly and you're unrighteous. And you don't teach your kids and your wife, you're not leading. You're not like Joshua, who says, for me and my house, yeah. Thank you, yeah, we will serve the Lord. And so if you're not doing that, you're ungodly and you're unrighteous. So it doesn't matter what you say. The Pharisees said what he did, and we thank God he was different than other men. So what Paul is saying in Romans is that there are people who, the wrath of God, they realize. And I told some of my brothers that live in the suburbs, and I said, often we'll talk about sin in the city. Oh, and so we're praying for the city. We're praying for the city. We're praying for the city. Man, because it's tough in the city. And I told some of my brothers who live in the suburbs, they love me, I love them. I said, only difference between sin in the city and sin in the suburbs, you guys got manicured lawns. Y'all look good when I ride through. You know, I ride through the suburbs, Canfield, Poland. Y'all look, ooh, this is nice. But inside, y'all just as sinful as anybody else. And they had to admit, yeah, that is true, isn't it? Yeah. You look good, but you're committing the same kind of sins. You mean to tell me adultery don't occur in the suburbs? I know better. You know, you see what I'm saying? You mean to tell me stealing, corruption is not in the suburbs? It's there. It's just in the city. It's like we do it, we can't cover it up. Y'all do it and y'all cover it up and nobody knows what's going on. So you don't get eternal life by doing good. Eternal life comes, and when you really have eternal life, your character changes. That's what he's saying. Because God's judgment is according to truth. You practicing ungodliness and unrighteousness, you are not going to see God, okay? And so he says, this is what happens when you genuinely get saved. So now, again, I've talked to a lot of people who say that they've accepted Christ, but your life hasn't changed. You still live in the same way. One guy I was talking with, I said, you know, you shacking up and you don't see anything wrong with it. I mean, but yet you say, but I'm a Christian. You ain't a Christian living that way. Because if you were a Christian, that there would be a continuance in doing good and seeking for glory and honor and immortality. The fact that you're not seeking for these things tell me that Christ is not in you. You see what I'm saying? Now let's go to Romans 3:3. Because it's 1 o'clock, we got to stop here pretty quick. Romans 3:3. Yes, sir. It says, for what if some did not believe? Will their unbelief make the faithfulness of God without effect? The answer is no. If I don't believe the truth of Scripture, does that mean that God's truth is less effective? No. What's verse 4 say? Go ahead. You with me? So just because I don't believe it doesn't mean it's not true. And he says, certainly not. God, indeed, let God be true, but every man a liar, as it is written that you may be justified in your words and may be overcome when you are judged. Okay, you got that? You see what he's saying? And so when you look at that, the amazing thing is there. And I tell people, and I said, God has helped me to say this to you. I don't care what you think about it. When you say something, and God is saying something different, God is saying that his wrath is upon you because you're ungodly and you're unrighteous. You saying, that's not true for me. Well, here's my answer to you. As it is written, here's my answer to you. Let God be true and every man a liar. You telling me you saved and living for Christ and you're living in sin and God says no, then God is true, you're lying. I mean, see, the Bible, and people, well, that's harsh. Sure, it's harsh. We need some harshness. Yeah, and I remember, I was looking at something for Sunday about Hebrews. I'm probably going to go to Hebrews 10. But I was thinking, I'm reminded of a time when my mother came out to get me. And it's summertime, sunshine, everything is going good. And she comes up and she shows up, and I'm in trouble. She must have called me and I didn't hear. And so, man, I'm looking at, this is my mom. She don't come out and get me. She'll send my brother or somebody else. So she came out, and I'm scared to death. And I start running, Mama, I'm sorry. I didn't hear you, Mama. I didn't hear you. She said, you ain't in trouble. I just decided to take a little walk. So here's the idea. Here's the idea. The Bible says you may not hear the prophets, but you better hear the Son. You better hear the Son. If you ain't hearing the Son, you see what I'm saying? you done hurt the prophets, you done killed the prophets, you done this and that, but you better not hurt my Son. He said, so God said, I'm speaking through my Son now. So you reject my Son, watch what happens to you. Because I ain't playing with that. This is my beloved Son. And you see what I'm saying? And so when we look at Paul, so I tell people, you better let God be found true. You saying you okay. God is saying you not. So go into the scripture. I'm going to go to the scripture and say, I'm not passing final judgment on you, but I'm telling you the way you're living is not Christian. And if you think you're going to stand before God living in sin, and God is going to say, I know your heart, young fella. I know you meant well. That ain't happening. And I told one guy, I said, and Jesus talked about a man. He says, Lazarus died, in Luke 16. Rich man died. And he said, and he lifted his eyes up in hell. He said, there ain't no purgatory. Ain't no way to pray that brother up. I pray him. He didn't stop at purgatory. He died and went to hell. You see what I'm saying? You don't die and go to purgatory and someone praying for you. No, he died and went to hell. Now, you say there's purgatory. Jesus said there's hell. I'm going to let Jesus be true and you the liar. And so, yeah, and so you don't make a lot of friends. People get upset when you just harsh. You just hard. Well, I want you to understand the truth. Yes, sir. As I close, like I say, I would get slightly sick. My grandmother would order the 3 sixes, black drop. Grandma, ain't no grandma. Open your mouth, boy. And I got well. I don't know whether I got well because of the medicine or because I didn't want to take the medicine. But either way, I got well. Father, we thank you for our time today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and praise God. Thanks for coming, everybody.